Hello and good afternoon, B-Sides Munich. My name is Frank Ulli and I'm a senior penetration tester and security consultant with One Consult Deutschland GmbH. We as the One Consult Group do offer security consultancy services and are originally from Switzerland, and our German offices are located in Munich. And today I'm happy to talk about the OWASP API security top 10, how APIs are hacked and how to develop securely. And I start by giving an introduction to the OWASP as a project to those of you that don't already know them, and the fact that there was an original top 10 list and still is aimed at web applications, why there was a need for a new top 10 list aimed at API security that was published recently at the end of 2019. I'll then get into each of the risks on that list and conclude with a summary about the root causes of these issues and how they might be mitigated. And finally, after this presentation, you can find in the appendix of the slides that are, of course, available, a large number of resources that I compiled about API security in general, but also about specific issues mentioned in the top 10 list. I'll begin by giving a brief introduction into what the OWASP and the original top 10 is. OWASP stands for Open Web Application Security Project, and since 2001, this non-profit organization aims at improving the security in the web. And probably the most well-known publication is the OWASP Top 10 list, which contains the 10 most critical or 10 most widespread issues found in web applications. And while I won't go into detail of any of these items on the original Top 10 list, if some or more of these terms does not ring a bell with you, for example, what insecure deserialization is or XML external entities, I highly encourage you to look into that original web top 10, since these issues might also arise in an API environment. But first of all, why the need for a new list? In the conventional days, the majority of work was done by the web application running on the server in the middle. But in modern ecosystems with microservices and RESTful APIs, actually, a lot of amount of work is done in the client side, either being a single page applications running in a web browser or mobile applications for iOS and Android. And depending on which statistic you asked, the majority of web traffic is now API traffic, but there is some kind of distinct differences between the conventional model and the modern model now that applications themselves query different APIs in different environments, and thus the new top 10 list. So the first item on that list is broken object level authorization. And this occurs if privileges of authenticated users are insufficiently checked at object level. And thus, attackers may be able to change an ID to that of another user and thus gain unauthorized access to data of other customers. And we take this example of rating a talk that you've registered to attend. If this is implemented this way, simply passing through the ID of the talk and the rating in the back end, and if there's no check, if the attendee actually registered for the talk, then anyone can vote for any talk, regardless if he did attend it. So what is the result? Data of other users is exposed. If this is a multi-tenancy environment, data of other tenants might be exposed. If access to data of other users is possible, this is called horizontal privilege escalation with roughly the same amount of privileges. But it might also be possible by this vulnerability to actually do vertical privilege escalation where one accesses higher privileged data. How can one identify this vulnerability? Dynamic application security testing is one of the main drivers to find this vulnerability, which I'll talk about in the next slide, but you can also do manual testing of the application and the API. And of course, you could also look at the static side of things where you're not looking at the running application as with DAST, where you're looking at the source code and try to identify vulnerabilities. And if you're trying to do dynamic application security testing, this is the classical approach where the application now, in this example, a single page application, talked via the cloud to the different APIs in the web. And you as an attacker now insert an interception proxy such as Burp or the open source that attack proxy and can now manipulate requests made by the application, but also you could manipulate and also view responses sent back to the application by the API server. So what could be done to prevent this issue? If you Google for this, you will come across solutions that don't really solve this problem. For example, blog posts might say, don't use such easily guessable IDs, do generate UUIDs. However, by using UUIDs and still not properly enforcing authorization checks, an attacker that knows the UUID might still be able to access this object. So the only solution is recheck the authorization for each reference, and ideally you would implement a decision engine, for example, that now does try to verify if this user is allowed to edit this user, if on the object level this user is allowed to see this object, and for administrative actions if this user is allowed to delete this object. So the second item is broken user authentication. And this issue arises when authentication and session management is not properly implemented. An attacker might be able to log on unauthenticated, impersonate other users, or steal passwords or session information. And why is this the common? Well, there are a large number of endpoints in APIs, but there are also distinct endpoints having to do with authentication, such as for a password, logon, or mobile logon, that do require special protection, such as a brute force mechanism preventing password guessing attacks. And if these mechanisms are missing, there are now weaknesses and vulnerabilities. But the other main cause has to do with misconceptions and misimplementations of newer technologies being used. For example, if one uses OAuth flows to make authorization assessments, there are various parameters that can be configured insecurely. There are, of course, classical issues such as passwords being saved without proper cryptographic measures. An issue I want to talk about in more detail is when JSON Web Tokens are used improperly. For example, JSON Web Tokens you would get back if you used an OAuth flow to authorize to your application. So it isn't JSON Web Token, you might have encountered them. JSON Web Tokens are self-contained tokens that in themselves contain all the claims and data necessary for an endpoint of a microservice architecture, for example, to make decisions whether this request is authorized or not without having to store session information on a central server, for example. So this is in contrast to classical session tokens that are reference tokens. And if you had a look at one of these JSON Web Tokens, you might notice that there are three parts. There is a header which contains information about the algorithms used, the main payload containing claims about who this user is and what his privileges are. For example, this user is not an admin, but also standard data points such as when this token was issued at and when it will expire. And in this solution, the security arises from the shared secret that's used to create the signature. The secret needs to be shared between the endpoints that issue the token and all endpoints that consume the token. And if we now take a step back and think about this for a second, you might notice some things right away. For example, the payload, the body of the token, is not really encrypted, it's Base64 encoded. So if there are some truly sensitive information such as social security numbers or even detailed birth dates, they are not properly secured. Second of all, an attacker can take a JSON Web Token, stuff it into a brute forcing program such as John the Ripper or Hashcat, and try to offline brute force guess the shared secret used to create these tokens. And if the secret is not strong enough, an attacker can guess this secret and now forge his own tokens. But in the early days of JSON Web Token libraries, but also if you would roll your own implementation of them, which is highly discouraged, if one implements the JSON Web Token specification to the letter, there is such a thing as the non-algorithm, where you can simply remove the signature and still have a valid JSON Web Token signed with the non-signature. The result will be privilege escalation and counterfeit tokens if we're talking about JSON Web Tokens, but if we're talking more generally about issues in this area, unauthorized access to data and unauthorized access to actions. So how would one identify the issues? By taking a bird's eye view of authentication, by asking yourselves, well, how are my users authenticated? How are passwords stored and transferred if I do that myself? How is user identification developed and managed? And are there actually strong guarantees about the identity of the user being used? And in detail for the JSON Web Token example, you can do dynamic tests by manipulating parts of the JSON Web Token, the signature or the header, or by doing static analysis. For example, if you have a look at your code, you should always make sure that you hard code the algorithm used and that you actually validate the JSON Web Token if it's still valid at the time it's consumed, and not simply decode it. And you should use a strong secret. So what are measures in general? Credentials and session ID should be protected. You should use standard mechanisms across the board for your entire solutions that are tried and true. If you've not followed the latest developments in password recommendations, I encourage you to have a look at the NIST 863 that talks about newer ideas about password complexity and password safety. Of course, you should enable your users to use a second factor if they wish so. And if you have to do with JSON Web Tokens, if your application consumes or produces them, I encourage you to look at the IETF draft talking about the best current practices. And of course, authentication not only is the login, there are other parts such as registration, user name recovery, or forgot password functionality that can have weaknesses that lead to the compromise of the applications. So you must take a look at them also. The third item is excessive data exposure. And while this issue is not specific to APIs, it's more prevalent because API-based applications provide a lot of data that is often first filtered by the client, and this data is also visible to an attacker that intercepts and manipulates the traffic. And thus an attacker may gain access to confidential information, for example, addresses or account details. And why is this so common? Well, the REST and API ecosystem encourages developers to implement APIs in generic ways, for example, simply taking in an object and outputting that as a JSON string. And if the filtering is done on the client side, for example, of this user profile, that on the client only displays the age, but actually transmit the birth date, an attacker that doth have a look at the traffic now knows potential sensitive data. And of course, you can imagine data even more sensitive than the birth date. So the result will be disclosure of sensitive data, and ultimately financial loss and damage to reputation. How could you identify such issues? By again taking a step back and by classifying your data, by tracking down where your application will create data up until the point where it will no longer need the data and when the data will be archived or possibly destroyed. By asking yourselves, well, which data is worth protecting and where and how is this data transferred and stored across the entire board of your solutions and also across possible third-party systems. And two, in terms of user privileges of the applications, but also as technical user privileges, such as database account users, should really be able to read or change that data. And of course, you can do dynamic tests by inserting an interception proxy and checking if your API exposes too much data. And at the code level, you can have a look for, depending on your framework and language, to remove generic methods that simply generate a JSON string, for example, with all the object properties. And more generally speaking, data should be protected or encrypted at each step, at rest, at transit. But newer technologies such as HTML5, APIs like session or local storage do enable developers to store data on the client side, but this data by default is stored unencrypted in the browser and is also accessible by every JavaScript originating from the same origin. So do protect data at every step sufficiently. So number four is lack of resources and lack of rate limiting. What does this mean? Well, if an API is not protected against a great number of requests or large payloads by implementing rate limiting or by rate limiting that is easily circumvented, attackers can execute brute force attacks, for example, on user accounts up to denial of service attacks. So what would be an example? This is a logon endpoint where you pass a logon and password. And of course, if there's no brute force protection, an attacker could try to guess the password. However, this example application has implemented some standard conform rate limiting where X rate limited header are given back containing information about what is the rate limit, how many tries are left for this IP address, and when will the rate limit be reset. However, there are infrastructure headers set by components such as reverse proxies or API gateways containing information about the original IP of requests that have passed through a larger environment, for example, X_4. And if an attacker is able to insert these headers, now he has circumvented rate limiting by telling the rate limit mechanism, well, I'm from this IP where in reality he's not from that IP. And this is an issue we see a lot in penetration tests. So brute force attacks are not prevented. Data may leak by an attacker simply requesting all data accessible to him and harvesting them, ultimately leading to unauthorized access to data possibly and denial of service if the system does not limit payload size, for example, if it's accepts arbitrarily large file uploads, then it then tries to interpret at the backend side, creating denial of service vulnerabilities. This issue could be identified by accessing the application in a different way, unauthenticated with incorrect credentials, and always making sure that there is a rate limit in place and trying to circumvent that rate limit by adding headers such as X_4 and observing changes in responses, observing changes in response time. So measures that should be taken. You should implement rate limiting for your API. 429 is a standard response. You should also implement a payload limit, talking about the size of the payload or the number of seconds or CPU amount of time that payload is processed in the backend. And you should never trust user input. Malicious user input or malicious input in general can not only be in parameters, but also in header fields. And headers that are affected by this issue are, for example, also X2 client IP or X real IP. But as these headers talk about the origin of a request, conversely, their headers set by infrastructure components such as X_host containing information about the target of a request. If an attacker is able to insert these headers and these headers are interpreted, there are other attacks possible such as web cache poisoning. So never trust user input. Number five is broken function level authorization. And this means that privileges of authenticated users are insufficiently checked now at the function level, in contrast to the object level we talked about earlier. And if an attacker is able to modify the path or method of a request, he might be able to reach privileged API endpoints, thus gaining access to administrative functions. And why is this so common? Well, in the olden days, developers were free to put, for example, a request to delete a user at an arbitrarily selected complicated path, such as the one pictured above. But in the modern API world, with RESTful development paradigms, if an attacker sees that a normal function to request a user is get API user, the user ID, it's easy for him to guess that, well, if this is a RESTful API, the endpoint to delete this user might be by changing the HTTP verb to delete. The result of this issue is exposure of high privileged functions. and possible vertical privilege escalation, as we talked about earlier. So measures in general to prevent these kind of authorization issues. Well, access to functions should firstly always make sure that the user is authenticated. API endpoints should be not accessible, access should be denied by default, except for resources that truly need to be public. And it has to be made sure that the user has the required role to access and execute the current function. And also generally speaking, for access to objects, it has to be made sure that the user has access authorization, either by being the direct or indirect owner of that object, and ideally also if he can access the object in the way he's currently trying to do so. He's trying to create, read, update, or delete an object. And most importantly, not relying on client apps to enforce any kind of authorization checks and to recheck authorization at the server for each reference. Point six is mass assignment. And while also not new in the web world, it's more prevalent in APIs because frameworks automate the conversion of client input into object properties. And if that's possible, an attacker can override possibly certain properties, thus gaining higher privileges, manipulating data, or bypassing security mechanisms. And in the example, there is an API that creates a user with a username. And if in this kind of pseudocode, this request body created by the user is simply passed to the database, well, then an attacker that can guess or infer by having, for example, the previously mentioned vulnerability excessive data exposure, an attacker that can guess that there is a parameter role containing authorization information, he or she might be able to insert this parameter and thus create an administrative user. How can this issue be found? It can be found by code reviews and by dynamic tests, and can be prevented by not automatically binding input from the client into objects. And prior to that, defining and allow listing expected parameters and values, and possibly protecting properties that should not be changed by making them read-only. And more generally speaking, by defining schemas, types, and patterns for the expected inputs of the application. Number seven is the umbrella term security misconfiguration. And this is one of the main causes of real-world security breaches and the most common finding in penetration tests. And this has to do with the fact that security is not only depending on secure coding practices, but also to a large degree on secure configuration that might be insecure, in fact, or that might be default configuration that is not secure by default. And depending on the impact of the risk, attackers might benefit from information about components being used to be able to further their actual attack up to complete compromise by the fact that a simple security misconfiguration is present. And this talks about, generally speaking, the fact that the attack surface of the application is larger than it needs to be. For example, defaults, passwords are being used, or any kind of unnecessarily attack surface is exposed. For example, ports or services open or running that are not necessarily to serve the business purpose, accounts being used that are by default, directory listings being enabled as three buckets if you're talking about the cloud environments being insecure, and so on. And the result will be data leakage. An attacker might benefit from simply executing exploits for publicly known vulnerabilities, unauthorized access to data, up to, as I said, complete takeover of the system. And these issues can be identified by doing regular vulnerability scans of the entire environment. And a specific vulnerability, due to time reasons, I cannot get into in detail, but I encourage you to be aware if you are using the underlying mechanism is cross-origin resource sharing. That is a mechanism to lessen the security guarantees by the same origin policy implemented in the browser to enhance APIs talkings to each other about different origins. However, there are a number of misconfigurations that can be arise with CORS, but there are tools such as CORS Scanner or CORSI you can use to run against your live application to check if these issues are present that are specific to APIs. Generally speaking, what can be done? Unnecessarily functionality should be disabled. You should implement a repeatable hardening process according to good practices for each component and layer of your solution. And ideally, you should use the same secure configuration for your development, test, and production environments. And generally speaking, segment your application architecture as much as possible and do automated tests of configurations and settings across all of your different environments. Injections, while being the number one item in the original web top 10, are only rated at place 8 by the API security top 10 authors. Generally speaking, injections happen when data is interpreted and the interpreter does not clearly distinguish between code and data, and it's possible that data is interpreted as code, and thus attackers may steal or modify data or execute code in the context of the application and thus possibly take over the system completely. And while there are some type of classical injections, such as SQL injections, that the API security top 10 authors argue are far less common today with modern frameworks preventing developers from making these mistakes in the first place, there are, of course, a number of interpreters in modern applications, NoSQL databases, XML interpreters. Applications do make LDAP queries or SOAP queries where injections are possible, so this is still a large attack surface. Solutions to identify injections are twofold. On the one side, doing a static analysis, having a look at the code and making sure that for each interpreter, there's a clear distinction between code and data by the appropriate mechanisms, but also augmenting this with tests of the live application and using manual or automated tools that do test the running application. Generally speaking, what are measures to prevent injections? Input validation should be one thing that your application should always do, including validating data that comes from your own systems or systems you have a trust relationship with, because these systems might be compromised too and not send you reliable, trustworthy data. Also, you should think about strictly defining all input data, expected format, expected values, possibly even allow listing only certain values, and you should make sure that the transfer from the data to the interpreter is secured appropriately. One example that prevents most SQL type injections would be to use prepared statements. And finally, a defend in depth measure would be to use output encoding suitable to the context where the data is placed and suitable to the interpreter that prevents meta characters inserted by attackers from being actually interpreted. The second to last point is improper assets management. And this issue arises when vendors lack an overview of existing systems, versions, or endpoints. And in case a vulnerability is detected in the latest version or release of the API, these older endpoints or versions are not retired or patched. And thus an attacker might be able to access data that originated from the production systems but was copied over for testing purposes to a quality assurance environment, which it compromises with the old unpatched vulnerability and now has access to very valuable data. The causes are that APIs are changing constantly due to continuous integration and continuous development and the generally accelerated pace of development in modern agile organizations. And if there is, for example, missing documentation that in version 1, for example, there was a get all users endpoint that might have been even accessible unauthenticated, attackers have now found an interesting entry point into your environment. Another example might be unknown API hosts, a quality assurance development environment where data from production was copied over to fix an issue, the data being forgotten there, and now with an older version of the environment exposing weaknesses and attacker compromising that and stealing very valuable production data. Measures that can be implemented to prevent this might be to inventory hosts and document API versions, to separate production and test and development environments as much as possible, ideally to not use productive data in these other systems, but still to apply the same security measures in all environments to get to know how they work and how they might interfere with business functionality and how they might have to be tweaked, but also to network and API firewall your endpoints sufficiently, also from requests stemming from internal systems that are not expected to make these requests. So to apply a healthy amount of what is called defense in depth. And finally, to force authentication in front of application exposing sensitive data or dangerous or powerful functionality, also if this is only an internally accessible service. The last point of the top 10 is insufficient logging and monitoring. And it's written in cursive because this is not strictly speaking a weakness, but more of a lack of technical and organizational protective measures that, when not in place, enable attackers to carry out attacks without being noticed, or in case incident or data leak is suspected, it makes it difficult to reconstruct if and which data was leaked. So while this topic could fill an entire talk, the root causes are that there possibly might not be logs for each component of the solution. Logs that are available are insufficient or are only stored on single machines and not sent to a central server where they can be monitored and automatic alerts can be fired for certain suspicious behavior. And if there is no incident response process, if there is no documentation about what to do in an incident, and if this has not been rehearsed, and then if there is some kind of issue with the application and an security incident is suspected, panic arises. So which measures should be implemented? Well, errors during, particularly during authentication and authorization, should be logged on a central server. There should be enough context to identify suspicious accounts and activities, but no sensitive data such as passwords or access tokens should be logged, which would make the logs themselves now an interesting attack surface. You should use a simple and unified log format, and ideally you would implement automatic alerts and create and rehearse a sufficient incident response process. So, in conclusion, some of the main reasons for security weakness and possible corrective actions. To prevent injections, you should do a healthy amount of input validation regardless of the source of the input, even if it's a system you would consider trusted, and to also encode output created by your application suitable for the context that it will be sent to. Do not place too much trust, especially in your client applications. Always make sure that security critical validation steps are taking place server side, and with every access to functions and objects, make sure that the current request is authorized to do so. To prevent issues introduced by the growing complexity of systems, you should introduce standardization as much as possible. For example, decide on one platform for identity and access management across your entire solution and environments, to document your design decisions and configurations, and to, of course, to automate as much as possible. And to combat a lack of defense in depth, you should isolate components of your own infrastructure from each other as much as possible to prevent one intrusion in some parts of your application somewhere in the cloud to spread across your entire solution or environment. So having that all that Is the OWASP API Security Top 10 a panacea to combat weaknesses in your APIs? No. It's a good practice document containing information about the 10 most critical risks as identified by its authors. It's a good first step if you want to make your API-based applications more secure, but it's intended on purpose as an awareness document to be read once. It's by no means a comprehensive standard that, if followed, guarantees security. It's, so to speak, the bare minimum to avoid negligence. So which publications does the OWASP have to offer if you want to take a more comprehensive approach to securing your solution? Well, if you want to do security-minded code reviews, there's the code review guide. If you want to dynamically test your applications, there's the OWASP web testing guide. The most current version is 4. Version 5 is in development, which contains very much details about vulnerabilities, how to spot them with dynamic or static analysis that is also very relevant to APIs. If you want to more of a take a preventive approach, for example, as a developer, you can have a look at the OWASP proactive controls that contains 10 items such as input validation and outlines what this means, what implication this has, how this can be implemented, and gives hints about possible libraries according to your environment and language. And finally, if you want to take a more holistic approach, you can have a look at the OWASP Application Security Verification Standard, ASVS in short, where you decide, well, how important is the data that my application processes? Which security level should I aspire to? And then the ASVS contains detailed checklists for each step of the software development lifecycle, beginning from design to really concrete implementation details, where you can have a look at and use the checklist approach to develop your applications more securely. And with that, I want to thank you for your attention. These are my contact details, and you can contact us at OneConsult with this data. And in the appendix of this presentation, as already mentioned, you find a number of resources that hopefully give you an even deeper insight into API security.